I received a video request on spdf orbitals along with these two questions. What does it mean when a statement says that the last electron enters the d orbital? And also, what does it mean when a structure is said to be sp or sp2 hybridized? I'm going to answer these two questions in this video. Let's start by looking at what are orbitals. They're basically the probability of finding electrons in an atom, and it exists in several types. The first type is s. It has only one orbital with a spherical shape. The second type is p. There are three of them looking like dumbbells. The third type is d. There are five of them. Four of them look like having two of the p orbitals combined together. And another one, the one in the middle, looks like there's a donut stuck in the middle of a dumbbell. And the fourth type is f. There are seven of them with assorted shapes like this. In each of these type of orbital, there are fixed number of electrons that they can hold. Now this is going to matter, so try to keep this in mind. Since each orbital can hold a maximum of 2 electrons, s can therefore hold 2 electrons, p can hold 6, d can hold 10, whereas f can hold 14 electrons. The way we come up with 2, 6, 10, and 14 electrons is we take the number of orbitals multiplied by 2 electrons because that's what each orbital can hold. So for example, for s, we only have one orbital, right? So we have 1 times 2, we get 2 electrons. We know that in an atom, protons and neutrons are located inside the nucleus, while the electrons are located outside the nucleus in electron shells. The nearest shell to the nucleus is going to be shell number 1. In shell 1, there is an s orbital, and we're going to call it 1s since it's located inside shell number 1. And in shell 2, we have 2s and 2p orbitals. And the same thing goes on and on for shell number 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. There is an order when it comes to filling up the electrons in the atom. We just have to keep in mind the number of electrons each orbital can hold. Remember that 2, 6, 10, and 14 that we went over earlier? We're going to need that. And coupled with an easy trick, we can write the electron configuration for any elements in a periodic table. So I'm going to show you how. The first arrow goes through 1s. S orbital can hold a maximum of 2 electrons, right? So we'll write 1s and then we put a 2 electrons there. The second arrow goes through 2s. Same thing, s holds 2 electrons, so we have 2s2. The third arrow goes through 2p and then only 3s. So we write 2p6, 3s2. Notice all the s orbitals will have 2 electrons, p orbital will have 6. And then we go on and on, all the way until we reach the end. At this moment, we only have 118 elements discovered in the periodic table. And so what we have written out here is the electron configuration for element number 118. As more elements are discovered, we'll get more orbitals, and we can use the same trick and we can continue on to write the electron configuration. Pretty simple, right? So now that we know how electrons are filled, we're going to answer the first question, which in fact applies to all transition elements. Just in case you need a recap, transition metals are the elements that are located in the middle of the periodic table. So let's look at one of the transition metal, which is vanadium, element number 23, and it has 23 electrons. These electrons will start filling up from 1s all the way until 4s, and with that, we've already used up 20 electrons. So vanadium has 23 electrons, right? So it will have remaining 3 more electrons. So the next orbital that the electrons are going to go to is going to be 3d. So we write 3d3. So the final electron is actually electron number 23, right? The final electron enters into the d orbital. And that is what it meant by the sentence. All transition metal elements will have its last electron located in the d orbital. Moving on to the second question. Sp and sp2 are hybridized orbitals, meaning the orbitals are mixed. And what do I mean by that? Let's take 1s orbital and we mix it with 1p orbital. It will give us 2sp orbitals. If we take 1s and we mix with 2 of the p orbitals, it's going to give us 3sp2. Similarly, if we take 1s and we mix it with 3 of the p orbitals, we're going to end up with 4 sp3. sp, sp2, and sp3 orbitals are said to be hybridized since they are a hybrid of s and p orbitals. Example of compound that contains sp hybridized orbital is the carbon in carbon dioxide. And for sp2, it's the carbon in formaldehyde. And in sp3, it's the carbon in methane. So you might be wondering, why do these orbitals need to mix together to form hybridized orbital? Well, the reason is because otherwise we can't explain the bonding that occurs in a molecule. Let's take CH4 for example. Carbon needs to make a total of 4 bonds with hydrogen, right? Because we have a carbon in the center and then we have 4 bonds to each of the hydrogen. Now, looking at carbon's ground state, there are only 2 unpaired electrons, which makes it impossible to make 4 bonds. At most, it will only make 2 bonds, and that's not good. However, if we mix one of the s with 3 of the p orbitals to get 4 sp3 orbitals, that 4 sp3 orbital is going to contain 4 unpaired electrons, therefore making it possible to bond with 4 hydrogens. That's why orbitals go through hybridization. With that, we've gone through a quick intro to spdf orbitals and the number of electrons that each of these orbitals can hold. We also talked about the electron configuration for transition metals, where all the final electron in the element always enters into the d orbital. And then we also look at how s and p orbitals are hybridized into sp, sp2, and sp3. Hope this video helps. Do subscribe, and thanks for watching.